generous introduction. Actually, I don't like to be called a former somebody. I would rather be called a future nobody. At least there is a future. I grew up in a rice farm, and I left the rice farm in 1966 and got back to rice only in 2011. So there was a long period of time when I was not involved in rice. But because of this exposure during my teenage years, I developed a special liking, a special attachment to rice. And the essay that you talked about, Self-Sufficiency in Rice and Philippine Progress, I almost forgot about it because that was written in 1966. I don't know if many of you were alive at that time. Okay. Dr. Masao, maybe a teenager at that time. But I can see a lot of young people here. Siguro yung lodo nyo, hindi pa pinapanganak in 1966. But that was the year when that award was given. I had to recall that because I like to remind you of how long this country has been obsessed with rice. Self-sufficiency in rice, to be precise. But we have been fighting and losing battle. In fact, historically, there were very few years when we were actually self-sufficient in rice. When we started making records of rice sufficiency way back in the mid-19th century, we were already importing rice from Siam or Thailand today. And in recent years, there were only 2 years when we actually hit sufficiency. One, I think, was in 1979, and the other one was 1992. So anyone who would like to put his political career at stake on the basis of self-sufficiency is bound to lose. And I think that's the reason why the present administration has lost in its quest for self-sufficiency. But this topic, I could not have given it, I could not have given this seminar when I was still director of Field Rice. Siguro yung mga taga-Field Rice ay paparinig ako kung nagbigay ako ng seminar na ganitong topic. And also, as far as the general public is concerned, if I give a seminar like this, perhaps they try to interpret it as politically motivated, that is, that we're trying to make an excuse for not producing enough rice, because rice is not good for you. So now that I have retired, I have no attachment to any organization except the National Academy of Science, which is neutral. I don't wear today a yellow shirt. It's not also red, so it's pink. And that's politically neutral. I don't carry any seal here, but the map of the Philippines. I'm here as a Filipino, like many of you who cares about this country and who cares about the role of rice in this country. Okay, let's move on. Yeah, this seminar is rated PG. It's not intended for 3.5 million families reported in the third quarter of this year as hungry. I don't think I will have the heart to tell them that rice is not good for them, because rice is their only food. In fact, in some instances, the only food available to poor people is rice and salt. I can say that because I have experienced it when I was a teenager. That's why I'm only this tall. Perhaps if I had a more balanced diet, I would be 6 feet or so, and I would not be standing here, but I'd be part of the Vilas team. So it's rated PG, and it's not for this sort of people who are hungry. But maybe it's for you, especially for those who habitually leave rice on their plate when they eat a Jollibee or wherever. And it's for those who prefer white rice. Viva, white rice is really good to eat. You can easily, that 5 cups per capita for an adult, that's really small. That is an average including babies. Hindi naman kumakain ng rice ang baby, so sa adult siguro, baka 7 or 8. And I believe that because we eat rice, breakfast, lunch, dinner, and sometimes yung merienda, puto, etc. is also made of rice. So that's how much rice we eat, and that's how we are dependent on rice. Well, since the title is very controversial, perhaps you would like to consider a less controversial title. And I have several suggestions here. You pick whatever title you prefer. I will talk about it in this seminar. So one is, white rice is not good for you. And at least, dinagdagan lang natin na white, yung original title, so it becomes more acceptable. And perhaps you will learn from this seminar why this is a more acceptable title for this seminar. The other one is, oh, what happened here? Too much rice is not good for you. Okay, so dinagdagan natin ng too much, yung rice is not good for you, and the context has become clearer. Now that's for the consumers, but what about the farmer? How do we make a more acceptable title? Kung ayaw niyo pumunta sa bukit at matagal ng farmer, ano mas acceptable na title? Maybe this would be a more acceptable title. So in all cases, we just added a few words and the title became more acceptable. Okay, let me summarize the arguments behind these very bold statements. One is that rice is not good for you because rice production contributes to maldistribution of wealth and other society problems. I'm sure you are aware of recent statistics which tell us that the distribution of wealth has deteriorated in recent years, that fewer and fewer families control a bigger and bigger share of the wealth of this country. And I will argue here that rice production contributes to this problem. The other side of this is food security. Rice is not exactly a good crop as far as food security is concerned, because we grow rice in areas that are prone to flooding. Rice needs water, and so we grow them in low-lying areas. That's exactly those areas that are prone to flooding. So when a typhoon comes, it's the rice crop that first suffers. And so if you rely on rice for food security, you're likely to lose the game. Argument number two, it's bad for the average farmer, because rice farming is not exactly a good source of income for the average farmer who owns only 1 hectare. And it's not also good for his health, as I will discuss later on. So it's bad for the country, it's bad for the average farmer, it's also bad for you and me, consumers. There's too much rice and cost and problems, and we are going to talk about that. So in the final analysis, if we want to make changes as a result of this seminar, we have actually two choices to make. One is that we preserve the status quo, which is rice in the farm as well as in the dining table, like what we're doing today. Or the other choice, and this I'm going to try and sell to you, this new system of food production and consumption, which means a more diversified farm, less rice, more of the other stuff, vegetables, livestock, poultry, and in so doing, we can achieve a lot more in 1 hectare of the rice farm. But diversification in the farm should be matched with diversification in the plate, because if the farm diversifies and the plate doesn't diversify, so there's no market for the farm produce. So it has to go hand in hand, diversification in the farm and diversification in the plate. Okay, now let's talk about why rice monocrop is poor economics. I said that the average land holding of rice farmer is 1 hectare. And from 1 hectare, based on studies made by Phil Rice and Iri combined, the estimated profit from rice farming is only about 50,000 pesos per year. Now, if we use 80,000 as the threshold of poverty, then it's so easy to conclude that you will only remain poor if you grow only rice. 50,000 is what you get. You need 80,000 to be able to reach the threshold of poverty. Second, the production cost per kilo in the Philippines is very high compared to rice exporting countries. It's not competitive. The production cost in the Philippines is 29 cents per kilo. In Thailand, it's 22 cents, about two-thirds that of the Philippines. And Vietnam is only 15 cents, so about one-half. So no wonder we buy it from these countries, because rice is cheaper from Thailand and from Vietnam. And with the ASEAN integration, you will expect that there will be more imports, and the farm gate price will have to go down. And what does that mean? The profit of the farmer will also go down. So it's not going to be 50,000 anymore. Maybe 40, maybe 30, and so the farmer will be expected to become even poorer than what he is now. But in spite of the high prices that, in spite of the fact that the farmers are poor, our farmer, as far as farm gate price is concerned, is better off compared to other ASEAN farmers. Our farmers get a better price for their palay than the Thais and the Vietnamese. And because of this, consumer prices here are very high. So we are punishing the consumer with high prices without necessarily liberating the farmer from poverty. So it looks like it's a lose-lose situation for both the consumers and the farmers. That's the situation today. Well, what about impact on society? I said earlier that it contributes to maldistribution of wealth. Well, the most recent study that I could find, you know, I studied for this seminar. That, of course, is a form of punishment because I was supposed to be retired. I should be enjoying life, but because of this seminar, I had to study. And the most recent study that I got was 1999. Somebody, I think the ERI group, surveyed Laguna, asked questions from the trader, the miller, the retailer, how much they are earning, and what did they find? The trader earned 5 times the income of the farmer. Okay? The miller got 85 times that of the farmer. The retailer, you know, in the Sapalenque, got 4 times that of the farmer. So talaga, kawawa yung farmer, you know? And there are very few traders, millers, and retailers compared to the farmers. So when I talk about maldistribution of wealth, I'm referring to this. The other side is the input suppliers. I don't have any statistics, but I have to ask you, have you seen a fertilizer manufacturer, a seed producer, or a pesticide producer or dealer who is poor? No, you don't see them poor. The only poor in the rice supply chain is who? The farmer. It's not that we can talk about the farmer, no? I see you crying already. That's compassion. We need compassion in this country. What is the other? Are you familiar with this? I'm not talking about Black Panda here. I'm talking about the OFW phenomenon. Again, somebody studied. Lahat naman ang ASEAN countries, all of them, are subject to this OFW phenomenon. But I think it's worse, well, the data shows that the highest level of migration, it's a 4-country study, I don't remember the other 3, but within ASEAN, in the Philippines, this is a 2009 study, 1/4 of the farm rice farm household survey at someone outside the farm. Well, in other countries like, I think Thailand and Vietnam, as part of this study, those who leave the farm do not necessarily leave the country. They go to the cities and help in the development of their own country. But not the Filipinos. They go abroad. Kaya yung mga nahuhuling lang lang bala ay mga rice farmers in Korea. And, worse, the ones who are leaving are women, not men, unlike, again, in other countries. So we're losing the cream of the crop. Well, assuming the women are the cream of the crop. You agree? Oh, okay. Well, there are quite a number of women here who would agree with me. The other side is the expense of healthcare costs. Well, assuming that the farmers, because they eat too much rice, would be, would have the tendency to develop diabetes, that is what I'm going to argue later on, then they will have to worry about the cost of diabetic care and how much is it. In the US, where the cost of medicine is lower than in the Philippines, it will cost about $12.5 million to provide health care for a diabetic, assuming that he is diagnosed at the age 50. So from the time of diagnosis to the time he dies, he will have to spend about 12.5 million pesos for diabetic care. But you will note also that the farmers are not only exposed to diabetes, but also to other hazards in the farm. ano pa ba yung ibang hazard? Snake bites? Well, that's nothing. But, you know the song, Magtalim ng Bibiro? That has a basis for ergonomics. If you bend the whole day, try doing it for a few minutes. I think you're gonna swear that you're not going to a rice farm and do rice farming. But that's the kind of work that farmers do. They bend during planting, they bend during harvesting. It's bad for ergonomics. Plus the fact that they're almost always submerged in mud. And in the mud, what do you get? Schistosomiasis, malaria, fungi, bacteria, blah, blah, blah. So snake bite is the least of the worry in the rice field. Now, let's talk about the environment. Is it good for the environment? Well, there's some evidence it's not. In terms of water, well, you can imagine, I don't have to tell you anything. Water is wasted in the rice farm. To produce 1 kilo of rice, you need as much as 5,000 liters of water. How much is 5,000 liters? Magkano pa isang litro ng mineral water? So you're throwing away 5,000 liters of that to produce 1 kilo of rice. So next time you waste rice, try to remember all the water that goes into rice production. Also, in terms of proportion of fresh water used in the farms, if you look at all the water used in farming for rice, corn, etc., all the crops in the world, 45% of all the water is used by rice. So that's how much rice water goes into rice. And in terms of evapotranspiration losses, rice uses 2 times more water than other cereals. Those are alternative foodstuff to rice. Now, what about energy balance? I have difficulty finding information on this, partly because the information available is so widespread in terms of the figures that I'm getting. The metric here is energy efficiency, energy produced divided by energy used in farming. And in Thailand, it's 0.5. For every unit of energy that you put into rice farming, you harvest only 1/2 unit. So it's very inefficient. It's 2 in India. And surprise, surprise, 8.25 in the Philippines. So in terms of energy, it appears we are the most efficient. But compared to corn, it's still very low because corn's efficiency is 11.4. So compared to at least corn, rice is not as energy efficient. Soil and water pollution. Well, since you're dealing with environment with high moisture content, and there's a lot of free water, then whatever pollutants are there can easily move to the next field, or eventually to Laguna de Bay, or to Manila Bay. So in fact, there is a Metro Manila Commission or something where PRIS is involved, and they are concerned about the pollution that comes from the Central Luzon, from the rice fields of Central Luzon, and eventually ending up in Manila Bay. There's a lot of pollution coming from farming, and I can imagine lots of it comes from rice farming. Pollution from pesticides, fertilizers, etc. Well, you are concerned about climate change, global warming. Well, rice is a big contributor to this. The recent statistics that I got seems to indicate that 10% of man-made greenhouse gas actually comes from rice farming. This is global, but it's higher in the Philippines, so at least we can be proud. And mas malaki ang contribution natin sa global warming, because 16% of anthropogenic greenhouse gas comes from our rice field. I don't know if you can be proud of that distinction. Now, let's talk about the farmer's health. I don't know if you are aware, a recent survey shows that the Filipino rice farmer is the oldest in Asia, based on the recent survey. I'll give you the figures. The average age based on the survey, this is quite recent, last year, 58 years old. The Thai farmer is 55, China 54, Indonesia 50, India 50, and Vietnam 49. So malapit ng maging senior citizen yung ating farmer. And worse, the level of mechanization is the lowest here. So matanda na yung farmer, wala pang machine. Ikaw, wala pa talaga. Now, what is the effect of rice farming on the health? I cannot find a survey here. Someone should do it. Ano bang effect ng bending, constant bending as a farmer? There was a survey done in India, and according to these figures, 99% of the farmers surveyed complained of lower back pain. Okay? Well, if you've been bending the whole day, that's what you get. Knee pain, 91% of those surveyed, and ankle pain, 83%. Well, I have not mentioned waterborne parasites, etc., that can also influence the farmer's health. But the worst of all is diabetes. If the farmer has nothing else to eat but rice, likely he's gonna get diabetes. So we're talking here about our farmer, who is the oldest, the poorest, and the most malnourished in the region. You are crying again. It's good. Now, what about you and me, the consumers? What's happening here? Okay. You want to read this? Late eating too much rice is linked to diseases of modern civilization. Heart failure, hypertension, stroke, arthritis, obesity, osteoporosis, gout, cancer, ulcer, you name it, we have it. These epidemics coincided with increased calorie consumption, coupled with decreased physical activities. And why is it a threat here? Because 80% of our calories we get from rice. Okay, now let's examine, we are all scientists, so let us examine the evidence. There's a lot of literature, and I can only get, given the time that I had, look at only a few. So what are these? A study in Japan and China, diabetes risk increased by 10% with its increase in the serving of white rice. One serving in those countries is about 80 grams. I think here one cup is about 100. Okay, so more than two servings is at least one cup. Another study, according to this study, during the Neolithic period, that is before we started cultivating rice, diabetes was virtually unknown. And how did they make this conclusion? They looked at hunter-gatherer societies. There are still many of them, maybe less than 100, but they surveyed Australian Aborigines and Eskimos in Alaska, and they found no diabetes in this culture. They don't eat rice, they don't eat grains, those that were introduced together with rice during the agricultural revolution. Number three, this is a 2009 study in the US. The incidence of diabetes and obesity started to increase in 1980s, paralleled by increase in carbohydrate consumption. Number four, here the subjects are obese diabetics. You don't have diabetes no matter the above. So when they tried to reduce carbohydrate consumption of obese diabetics, they were able to reduce the weight and improve the response to insulin. Another study showed that diabetics are 2 to 3 times more likely to have coronary heart disease, and 44% will develop atherosclerosis, meaning hardening of the arteries, which eventually result in high blood pressure, and 20 to 25% will develop impaired kidney. So if you are a diabetic, because you eat too much sugar, you eat too much rice, I use the term sugar and rice interchangeably, because eventually the starch that you get from rice becomes sugar once it is digested by the human body. As you know, starch is a polymer of glucose. It's glucose chain. Here is a mouse experiment. Age here refers to advanced glycation. I have to check my notes. Well, anyway, what happens is sugar in the blood binds with protein, and the effect is like what you get when you caramelize something. It becomes hard, and that's what happens. So the product of that reaction is what we call AIDS. So it's a study that was done, they fed mouse with AIDS, which is a byproduct of too much glucose in the blood, and that's what they got. If they give too much AIDS, end result is hardening of the artery. And on the contrary, if the AIDS is low in the diet, the mouse became healthier. Of course, you would love to see this done with humans, but I don't know who would like to volunteer. you will be given an AIDS-rich diet. Any volunteer? Okay. You love yourself, so you don't like to die. Okay. This is the last in my list. From the University of Connecticut. When carbohydrates was reduced to 10 of the total calorie, remember, we get about 80% of the total calorie from rice. In this experiment, the diet was reduced to 10% of the total calorie from carbohydrates. You see, you get calorie from protein and fat also. So in fact, you can get all your calories from proteins and fats. In this experiment, unlimited amount of beef, poultry, fish, eggs, cheese, nuts, and the result, the low density lipoprotein, the one that is being blamed for heart attack, for hardening of the artery, is reduced by 26% after 12 weeks. So this is just a sampling of the evidences that I examined. If you look at literature, there's a lot of them. So you ask, why does rice cause all of these diseases? Well, number one explanation is that it's a fairly recent component of our diet. Remember, we started to cultivate rice only about 8,000 to 10,000 years ago. But the humans have been in existence, well, if you count our ancestors, Lucy, 3.5 million years ago, she was already walking in Africa, and she was not eating rice, because we started to eat rice maybe not earlier than 200,000 years ago, because that's the year when we started cooking with fire. You cannot eat raw rice, can you? So you have to cook it. So perhaps we started to eat rice only 200,000 years ago, but we started to cultivate it only about 8,000 to 10,000 years ago. So perhaps your exposure not there in large quantities can be dated back to only about 8,000 years. Evolutionary time, that's too short. And perhaps the human body has not adapted to grains consumption, including rice. Well, rice is essentially starch. Among the cereals, it has the lowest protein content, so don't count on getting protein from rice. And whatever little protein it has, lacks essential amino acids such as lysine, lacks minerals such as iron and zinc, and it doesn't have vitamin A and ascorbic acid. So likely, if your diet is very high in rice, you're going to have deficiencies in iron, zinc, and vitamin A. And indeed, 1.7 million Filipino children under 5 years old are suffering from vitamin A deficiency. The other thing is that the anaerobic condition of the soil, which is favorable for arsenic uptake by rice, would perhaps result in accumulation of arsenic in the rice grain. And in fact, from time to time, you hear of arsenic in rice. Of course, these are small quantities, and a lot of people are not too worried about it. Now, on the opposite side, if you don't like arsenic, you prefer to grow rice under aerobic condition. In fact, there is a technology for aerobic rice. Then you will have problems with cadmium. So you will have to choose your poison. Do you like arsenic? You grow rice in submerged environment. You like cadmium? Grow rice under aerobic condition. This is what the literature seems to indicate. Well, you grew up with rice, so perhaps you think that you cannot live without rice. But actually, humans do not need rice. Because as I mentioned, the energy we get from rice, we can get from other foodstuff like fats and proteins. And this is the reason why our ancestors survived before rice. I'm not suggesting that we eat meat, because today meat production uses a lot of calories. According to the statistics I gathered, you need 28 calories of feed for every calorie per week. So it's not exactly a good source of calories. But of course, we are surrounded by water. And rice itself is growing in water. So if you have water, you have fish, you have ducks. And in fact, rice duck, rice fish is one of those things that I would like to suggest in this seminar. So what's wrong with rice? Okay, I said starch turns to glucose, and glucose accumulation in the blood would have its consequences. Well, unlike other carbohydrates, rice tends to give this kind of behavior, a spike in glucose, and together with it, the spike in insulin. Now, this is followed by a drop, because if because of the high glucose you induce insulin production, then the tendency is for the glucose to go down, and when glucose goes down, then you feel that you need to eat. You eat more rice, and so glucose goes up again. So this roller coaster with its peaks is the one that causes problems. Okay, lang if the glucose doesn't peak too much, as happens when we eat other sources of carbohydrates. But rice has that behavior. Why does rice behave that way? You have to look at this data, glycemic index. Unlabbed glycemic index, I'm sure a lot of people here know better than me what that is. But that is the speed at which glucose reaches the bloodstream after being digested. So the higher the glycemic index is, the more likely you're going to have this glucose peaks, and the more likely you're going to get the kind of damage that results from eating high glucose food like rice. So what do you see here? Ah, white rice, this is your favorite. 70. It's even higher than sugar. This is 65, by the way, is high in sugar. Meron pa nga nakita na 59. So, mas delikado pa pala yung rice kisa sa sugar. So, because rice is a potential hazard, you probably switch to something else. So what do you switch to? You eat bread. Oh, it's like jumping from the frying pan into the fire. Because bread, where is bread? 93. So if rice is bad, don't eat bread. It's worse. So other choices. Well, if you like rice really, you're really obsessed with rice, well, brown rice is a good option. 50. Okay? So, well, there's a lot of people here who can talk about brown rice. I hope we can talk about brown rice after my talk. But this is our savior, brown rice. Any rice can be made into brown rice, by the way. It's not a specific variety, it's a milling process. You can even make red rice into brown rice by the milling process. Okay, the other alternative, which is even better, is parboiled rice. In fact, this is the reason why India, which also consumes a lot of rice, doesn't have as much problem with diabetes as the Philippines. Because about more than 50% of the rice consumed in India is parboiled. What is parboiling? It's soaking in water and steaming. That somehow changes the starch in the rice grain and becomes less digestible, and so you get a lower glycemic index. So, not all rice is bad. Brown rice is good, parboiled rice is good, some varieties of white rice are good. In fact, Eri surveyed more than 200 varieties of rice, and they found as low as 45 and as high as 92. But the average is 64, still higher than sugar. Well, about the same as sugar, but the low analysis for sugar is 59. Okay? So there you are. What else can you eat? Well, the Department of Agriculture has been saying all along, eat camote. Kung hindi kayo makapasa sa UP, go home at plant kamote. You'll be better off because the glycemic index of kamote is only 32. Cassava, 15. Saba, 53. White corn. Oh, pandesal. Don't eat pandesal. So, these are our options. Okay, now let's look at the glucose, effects of glucose spike. So this is just a short list of what you're likely to get. I'm not trying to scare you, but all of these are supported by scientific studies. You can also get osteoporosis and muscle loss, sarcopenia. So you become thinner and you become more frail if you eat too much rice. Well, that's what happens when you eat starch, glycogen, saccharides, monosaccharides. These are the carbohydrates that you consume. And what happens is that they are converted into glucose. And some of them are stored in the form of glycogen in the liver. And if you eat too much, then you find them floating in the bloodstream as free glucose, and that's the one that is causing the problem. Well, I don't know how to make this using the PowerPoint. So what I did was I tried to make it on my coupon band, took a picture. What I'd like to illustrate to you is what happens to glucose. Okay, I talk about age, advanced glycation, and product. And what happens? Oh, you're gonna make your melanin skin wrinkles. You want to avoid rice. You make your malilimutin up. You like to avoid rice. And here is a short list. The last one. I don't know if you would be happy if you have that problem. The other product, well, this is free glucose that causes age. The other one is, as I mentioned, it may result in peaks in insulin, and it will result in visceral fat. Kaya, yung fat, it's not just ordinary fat, it's fat that accumulates in your middle of your body. That's why you develop the fat here. It's not here, but here. So medyo hindi magandang tingnan. So if you have this, you may get damage to pancreas and it will result in diabetes. If you get this, you may get insulin resistance in the cells, you may get diabetes. And if you have diabetes, as I mentioned, you're more likely to get coronary heart disease, high blood, kidney failure. Visceral fat will also cause the inflammation, coronary heart disease. More than that, rice is addictive. Why? Because we feel we have not eaten if we have not eaten rice. Have you experienced being asked, kumain na ba kayo? If you haven't eaten rice, you say no. Even if you have eaten pandesal or whatever else, you have not eaten if you have not eaten rice. There's a reason for that, because the glucose will tend to result in serotonin release. Serotonin is the happy hormone, so you feel good. You feel addicted. So it's rice can cause some form of addiction. Now, why Filipinos specifically? Why are we picking on ourselves as a victim of rice? Because we eat too much. The global average is only 65. And practically every country on this planet has a decreasing trend for rice consumption. Filipinos lang ang tumataas from 92 in the 80s and 90s to 119. I even saw a report, 123. So it's really going up. Now, I mentioned that some countries with high per capita consumption have less problem because they eat carbohydrates. And in the case of Indonesia, which also uses a lot of rice, they eat other fiber-rich food. So, question. If rice is so bad, why do we eat it? Well, here are some of the theories. It's the cheapest source of carbohydrate today. Second, we are already addicted, so talagang we have to keep on eating. Convenient? Yeah, really. You can easily transport rice, you can easily store, and it's so easy to cook, especially with the automatic rice cookers. Now, wala pang automatic kamote cooker, so it's really convenient yung kamote kainin. Status symbol, pagka rice. Pagka ikaw, Chris, sabihin mo ako kumakain ng kamote. Hindi mo rin ang pakinggan. So, even if you're eating kamote, perhaps you're going to deny it and you'll say you're eating rice. Well, our parents and grandparents did, so tradition is one reason. The other question is, if rice production is so bad, why do farmers continue to grow rice? No choice. If your land is, always flooded, your choices of crops are very few. Rice, kangkong, you know, like 1 hectare of kangkong. So the only suitable crop there is rice. And besides, rice farmers, since they are malnourished, their education is low, they know no other skills. Hindi man sila marunong ng PowerPoint. So, alam lang nila, it's rice farming. Well, to them, it's better little income than nothing. Buti na yung 50,000 ka, it's as a zero. And also for household food security. This is very important because based on the study of our national scientist, Elia Castillo, the Filipino, average Filipino farmer doesn't feel secure if he doesn't have several sacks of rice in his food bodega. So to him, rice is food security. So he has to keep on growing rice. But I think this is the most exciting reason. Ilocano farmers grow rice because they need rice so they can grow garlic and vegetables after rice. The rice crop, because it's in submerged soil, tend to sterilize the soil because of the water condition. It kills a lot of pathogens that may influence the next crop. So it's good for growing upland crops like garlic and vegetables. And I think this is a very good introduction to the solution that I am proposing. Here, we have a problem with low income. I said, now this is starting to make sense. If you start talking about garlic and vegetables in addition to rice, then that's really starting to make sense. So, this is what I propose. Less rice, more of the others, is better for farmers and consumers alike. And how do you do this? The formula is IRD, intensification, diversification, and integration. That is the strategy. Intensify so that you can grow more, not only rice, but other crops, maybe even livestock, poultry, fish, in the same piece of land. That also results in diversification and integration. We try to grow them not at random, but try to promote symbiosis, synergy among the different components of your farming system. You can talk about vertical integration as one example, and horizontal integration. So one of the things that we're trying to push here By we, I mean Phil Rice, because Phil Rice, since last year, has been trying to push this strategy. Mushroom can be produced using rice straw. In many places in this country, rice straw is a problem. It's being burned. To solve the problem, they burn the rice straw. So instead of burning the rice straw, you can use it as a substrate for mushroom. And the spent mushroom substrate can be fed to carabao. The carabao manure can be fed to worms, vermiculture, and the vermicast that comes out of this goes back to rice. So beautiful vertical integration. You are your own market, because the carabao, it's the mushroom, and spent mushroom, and product of vermiculture goes to your rice field. Mushroom, I was just talking to an entrepreneur over lunch, and sabi niya, mushroom 120 pesos per kilo. So that's a lot better than how much is rice. 20 pesos per kilo. Okay. So in horizontal integration, there's a lot of options. Some pictures here. Let me say a few words about fish. I'm really excited about fish. Fish is only one of more than 500 species of fauna that you can find in a typical rice field. It's a rich field for biodiversity. And in a survey in Thailand, there were 18 species of fish in one rice field. These are native in the rice field. Rice fish culture is not new. The Chinese have been doing it for millennia, and based on the literature we gathered, you can easily get 500 to 2,000 kilos of fish from a rice field. And the profit is three times what you get from rice alone. So it makes a lot of sense to grow fish with rice. And more than that, it's a good combination. The protein from fish plus the carbohydrate from rice can give you good nutrition. There's another photograph. Garlic here. And this is the rural transformation movement that I'm talking about, using IID as the technology package. Field Rice has launched this. And I understand UPLB students are involved here. Thank you for your interest. You are supporting a very good cause. So, what do we have? What do we want to gain from the rural transformation movement? We aim to increase the farmers' income, promote environmentally sound farming practices, create rural employment, provide nutritious food to consumers, and this is open to everyone. Farmers, students, consumers, everyone who would like to join. Please contact the Spanish branch of Field Rice if you want to be involved. And if you like to know more about that movement, you can actually download these issues of Field Rice magazine from the Field Rice website, www.fieldrice.gov.ph. It's free, you will not be charged. And you will find a lot of information there about the rural transformation movement. Well, let me end this talk with a quotation from Arthur Schopenhauer. A truth passes through three stages. First, it is ridiculed. Second, it is violently opposed. And third, it is accepted as self-evident. The single generally unknown truth from this seminar is rice is not good for you. But we can make it better through IID or IDI. Well, the Open Forum will tell us whether this truth will be ridiculed, it will be violently opposed, or accepted. But the worst thing that can happen is if it is ignored. So, have a nice day, fellas. Thank you.
gathered from Dr. Rasco's seminar. You may use the microphones, get it along with us, and please kindly introduce yourself and the organization you are connected to. Anyone from the Yes, Dr. Powell.
Hi, good afternoon. It appears na very effective yung ngayong title, ano? It drew a lot of attention, especially from students. Are most of these students? Okay. So actually, it's not really a question, but a comment. It is true that eating rice alone is not good for our body. Ngayon, yung mga, well, my observation when I go to the restaurants, ano, here in UPLB, or sa Probe, ang mga estudyante, they will order 2 cups of rice, and then buy some fish or meat, at ihingi sila ng sabaw na adobo para isabaw doon sa kanin. And of course, we know that indeed in this country, rice is cheap. 7 pesos lang yung white rice. Pag may 2 cups ka, tapos may isang serving ng ano, less than 50 pesos magsusurvive ka sa isang meal. At on the other hand, nakikita ko din naman, mostly itong mga boys ito, because they need a lot of energy, no? Because of the activities during the day. And hindi nila nalalaman ang problema because they're young. But no, take note, mga estudyante, when you reach the age of 40 and you don't change your eating habits and your lifestyle, then doon darating ang lahat ng problema. Take it from us na mga seniors na. ako, when I, back in 2010, talagang I stopped eating white rice when I learned about brown rice. Kasi, sabi ko, bakit ako kakain ng white rice? Wala naman palang nutrition na nabubuha dyan. Sayang lang yung pera ko. So I eat, from there on, I eat brown rice. You don't see me eating in parties and all that. Pag walang brown rice, I just eat vegetable, meat, and fish, whatever, but except rice. So may ano nga doon sa mga estudyante, because rice, brown rice is not really acceptable para sa mga kabataan, ano? Kasi it takes a while to get used to eating brown rice. Sabi nila, coarse daw, pangit yung itsura, etc., all that. But then, ang kailangan lang talaga is to accept the truth that brown rice is really healthy and nutritious. And your system gets used to it. Eh kung brown rice is pangit, eh, sabawan nilang adobo para hindi nyo makita yung kulay, no? Mapula na yon. Tapos lagyan nyo ng gulay sa ibabaw, yung mga sitaw, kalabasa, and all that. But then, I am a strong advocate of brown rice. I'm retired, I'm senior citizen, and mind you, talaga brown rice is really healthy. So itong mga kabataan na to, I advise you na mag-change kayo ng inyong lifestyle. Ang pinakataka nga lang kung bakit si Dr. Rasco, kung nasa field rice, eh, hindi niya ito in-introduce sa mga constituents niya sa field rice. Well, he said before na he cannot do that. But being misunderstood na kung mag-diversify ka, eh sabihin nila, hindi na yan field rice, other crops na yan. So I really very thankful for this seminar. And sana, makapag-seminar ka pa sa ibang audience naman. Because really, this is very important for our young people now. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Paul. Yes. Yes, sir.
Many years ago, 5 years ago, he Many of you were not born yet. IRI had a program called multiple grabbing, headed by Dr. Richard Bradfield, and Dr. Leandro, national scientist, is here to attest that. Now, that is a kind of crop diversification, but crop only, no chickens. I think that propose chickens or ducks or fish. But one of those other crops, other than rice, is kamote. Yeah, and the farmer can harvest 12 tons of kamote, and now it's more than that. So technology has increased the yield. The other is, I think, sweet corn, cassava. And this leads me to another new one, which perhaps most of you do not know yet. Soybean, vegetable soybean, or edamame. Now, if you want to taste edamame, tomorrow is a Christmas bazaar at IRI. I will sell edamame there. If you like to taste edamame, I tell you, you will not like rice again, maybe. And then brown rice also. Brown rice also. That's brown rice that you will ever taste. Surpassing maybe field rice, brown rice. Anyway, that's a little commercial, but try it because brown rice is healthy. And the edamame or vegetable soybean is also healthy. And when I was in high school in Lipa City, we used to eat nilagang utaw, which is edamame. Edamame in nilagang utaw was sold a little bit yellowish already, so very mature. But edamame, the origin of this is, well, the most consumer of edamame is Japan, and imports 99,000 tons of edamame from Taiwan. Because during winter, they cannot raise edamame, so they import from Taiwan. And you might as well do that, raise soybean edamame. So tomorrow, don't forget, if you want to taste edamame, it is there, obviously. And if you want to buy seeds, it is there also. Raise them in your garden. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. That's one commercial for all of us. We go to IRI tomorrow.
Hello, good afternoon.
Yes,
I'm Amia Nardiza. I'm also a former student of Rasco who was teaching 4020. I'm so glad to see him again. I appreciate your talk, sir, that you gave a strong statement, a very controversial title that I'm sure a lot of people will be intrigued. But I'm glad you are here to talk about it more. We started campaigning about good food, you know, health and wellness at the UPMP Crop Science through several series. We've talked about soybean. We had a big campaign on campus about brown rice last June, and we invited people from FNRI demonstrating and cooking. I have to check it if it's okay at the OVCRA website, because we have also a speaker about rice processing on brown rice because they have technology. And we also have Dr. Nandin demonstrate a small, you know, tabletop rice processor from Japan that he uses to sell, you know, his product here at Lopez Avenue. So we actually have lots of work to do. I did a short survey, like a mini food diary among my students, and I'm so glad to see their plates. Kasi yung mga plato talaga. No, ay karamihan ay gray or brown ang kulay. If you look at the new FNRI, or like the tawag na pinggang Pinoy, apat na bahagi na yung pinggan. 1/4 ng yung kanin. No? Yung protein source is another 1/4, and 1/4 is supposed to be vegetable. And another 1/4 is supposed to be fruits. And I'd like to warn everybody, because you have to read as well, kasi yung mga recent studies ngayon allows, we need to integrate crop disaster preparedness, climate change, shortage of water, increasing populations, ang dami daming problema. So parang pag-isipin natin, I'd like to tell you the story because I was in Leyte in December of 2013 after Yolanda. Doon ko narinig yung kwento ng mga tao kung paano sila nagutom kasi dalawang linggo walang bigas. So ano kinukwento ko to sa mga estudyante ko, sinabi ko sa kanila, it has happened, it can happen again. Let's just hope that it won't happen to everyone, you know? To every one of us, because it's really a disaster. For now, 2 years na, medyo mas naiigil na. Nakabalik ako noong 2014. Malaki na improvement. Pero nung kapapasok ko nung halos Pasko yun, hindi sana mangyari sa atin. Pero yung anong nakasave sa mga tao? Yung mga tao alam kung saan may gabi, no? Kung saan may, at saka yung mga those farmers who know what the edible plants are in the mountains. So we have to look at a lot of things. What indigenous food we need? Ang dami natin native material na kailangan natin matutunan kainin. Tulungan natin yung maliliit natin mga magsasaka, no? Aside from that, with regards to health and safety, I've been involved as a supporter of the movement with Dr. Rasco. Before he exited, he already campaigned on this. And what I remember he strongly said was, he is accepting that their generation is not able to solve the problem, but I guess the young people in this room will be the one to solve the problem. But I can share a brief experience. I had the chance to also give in New York for a Dr. Rasco study. And there's a big change in my diet there because there's no Philippine restaurant. There's very little time to cook. No, at first, I don't have gluten, but when you have demands in grad school, you can do that. But the point is, even when I came back to the Philippines, my time, tinest ko sarili ko. I was happy. Maraming masasarap kainin kaysa puro kanin. I was able to eat well for 21 days without rice. Hindi ko na siya tinocument, pero I tell you, pwede. And then I also tried to have some diet before I interview ko yung mga sudyante ko. How much is the allowance of a UPLB scholar? 2,000 pesos a month. How can I live with like 500 pesos? Sabi ko, a week? So there's a time that I just sort of tested myself, how can I live a week with 500 pesos? You have to know where the nilagang sabay, nakamotes are. And that, you know, it's hard but it can be done. You know, yung subsistence living. Pero ang totoo, ang hirap madali utak pag hindi masarap ang kinain. Yun lang po. So I invite people, we're having another end of the semester campaign at the agronomy building from December 2 to 4. So it'd be a mini party like we've had for the past 2 years. So you're all welcome to come. We'll have announcements. And part of it is the food people campaign and entrepreneurship. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for your comments. But pero, any questions for Dr. Rasco, please?
I don't have a question. I just want to comment on Juliano, the big rice.
Yes, sir.
Too much of any food in the diet is really bad. The data on the glycemic index of rice really does not give a representative value for rice. Because rice, the glycemic index varies from very high to very low. The worst kind of rice in terms of glycemic index is balakid, no? Glutinous or wax meal. So people who consume waxy rice, better watch out because they're bound to have diabetes. On the other extreme, the very high amylose types are low glycemic index. The trend in the Philippines is towards lower amylose. This is why we are very concerned that right now the average amylose content of rice that we consume is intermediate amylose. It's going to low amylose with higher glycemic index based on the breeding program. One of the things that worry me also is the satiety of brown rice and lean rice. When studies at FNRI and Professor Ning Felix have shown that the there is no reduction of rice consumption when you substitute brown rice for wheat rice. The differences are not significant. There is a difference, but not significant. So I cannot find any data that shows that consuming brown rice will reduce rice consumption so far. Thank you.
So I have a question for. So I find the agriculture program really fragmented kasi meron pa yung crop bean, rice, coconut, tapos yung may organic agriculture program. Tapos maraming, watak-watak kasi, ang hirap, hindi ba? Pero sa maraming scam, parang it's, and then there's a separate LGU. How do you propose if you become the next being secretary? How do you propose to do this?
Well, you are aware, yung talagang kaalakalan. Meron especially sa rice, sa corn, etc. And within rice, especially sa plant breeding, sa chemistry. So we tend to specialize in a very narrow field. And very few people actually want to look at the big picture because it's hazardous. Looking at the big picture and trying to talk about the big picture is hazardous to your career. Why? Because you can only specialize in a narrow field. And once you start talking about other things, like in my case, I talk about anthropology, I talk about sociology, economics, that's not my line of expertise. But I'm old, so I can take risks.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Rasco, for coming out of your retirement to give us that little stimulating talk. I'm not going to ridicule it. I'm not violently opposed to it, but there are a few questions I have before I accept it as self-evident. You said the reason we're eating rice is because it's cheap, we're addicted to it, it's convenient, it's a status symbol, and it's tradition. None of those things change very easily, and the solution that you've put forward doesn't seem to address them. So maybe you didn't have time, but could you say how you overcome those barriers to reducing rice production, and perhaps touch on what's happened in other countries, why their consumption is going down while Philippines is going up.
I was afraid you're going to ask that question. Culture is very difficult to change because the explanations that they gave is all about culture. We are used to doing it, and it's like, how do you convert Christians into Muslims? That's not easy. But with all the information we have here, my hope is that whoever learns about this would support a movement like the Rural Transformation Movement that advocates more diversity in the farms and more diversity in the diet. Because that's the only key. Only work, diversity, right? Well, there were attempts in the past, like I think Dr. Mateen mentioned about the former program of ETI, the multiple cropping. And FIRRAIS has its own program, Malayamina. But my impression is that those programs did not progress very well because the main objective was household food security. So it's the farmer feeding himself. The farmer needs more than food, he needs money. So the key here is scale. You can teach him to do multiple cropping, but do it not only for household food security, but also, and more importantly, for income. He needs more than food. He needs money to buy a loan for his cell phone. You know, the other requirements of surviving in this country. So scale, really scale, but yeah, changing culture. That's why we talk about movement. It's not a project, it's not a program, because projects and programs, they usually ask you, when is this going to end? A movement can span for decades, for years, for hundreds of years, if necessary. But something has to change.
Thank you.
And I hope the change starts here, in this room.
Yes, sir.
My name is Jenny Latinia, from the College of Economics and Management. And it's very interesting to be in your presentation. In fact, our students are actually helping out a little bit in surveying some of these things for RISE. But I'm curious to who is how, of course, coming from field RISE, I feel like it's also like quite a risk because to promote it when you're in field RISE, because it basically means that we should, if you say diversify, right now, for example, policy, it's a lot of our policy is really supporting towards investments for rice. For example, irrigation is all about rice, and therefore shifting all of that support towards other crops, that's kind of a very different kind of approach. So one possibility or one question is how do we convince, one is the consuming public, the other is policy. How can we influence, for example, with EA and also even field rights, which would go up?
It's really a small paradigm shift. And I talk about it a bit. Pero mukhang walang makagets. It's a shift in focus of what we're doing from the rice plant to the rice farmer. Okay, the rice farming environment where you can grow other crops in addition to rice, where you can grow fish, you can grow ducks. So the unit of analysis is no longer the rice crop, how much yield you get from the rice crop, but the totality of what you can get from the rice environment, including garlic, fish, ducks, everything that you can grow there becomes part of the yield of that rice environment. And who benefits from that is the rice farmer, who happens to be a garlic farmer also, who happens to be a fish grower also, but is most of all basically a rice farmer.
Just like what Dr. Juliana said, our best eating rices apparently are not the best rices because of we are on more low and intermediate amylose. But you're saying better for us is the higher amylose rices. The same is true with this crop diversification. The best land we have, of course, are the irrigated rice. Second to that would be the rain-fed, and the third is the upland. But where we grow rice twice in the low-lying areas, those are the places where we have difficulty in crop diversification. That is, transforming aerobic soil condition, drying it up, and making it aerobic for most crops. Otherwise, if you don't do that, you have no choice but campo and agave. If you go to rain bed, then you have a better opportunity for a dry season crop and diversify. In fact, I think in these places you'll find the garlic and these more valuable crops, high value crops. If you go on the upland, the only limitation is the rainfall. You've got a lot of opportunities. You have got upland rice, you have got radish, mustard, and so on during the dry season. So while it's easy to say that we need to diversify crops, the best of our rice lands are not really the best for diversification. It's because of this transformation from transforming from anaerobic to aerobic.
But does it have to be crops?
Yeah.
If you have lots of water, fish like that.
Yeah,
ducks like
crops.
That. And the advantage of ducks is if there is a typhoon, you can bring them inside your house. The rice stays, you know, in the field, hindi man makatakbo yung rice. So you have damage to the rice crop, but you save the duck. That's good security.
You will get carried away, but ducks can swim.
Yes.
Can swim.
Masaya yan, pag maraming tubig.
But I think that's it. Many would have to diversify. In fact, many feel that they would get more money from dryland crops than from flooded crops like rice. For example, garlic is a good example. In fact, if you have 2 hectares, if you have 6 hectares of rice and you can plant them all to garlic, ayun ang sinasabi natin, milyonaryo ka na.
Sure, because if we look at the model of how agriculture is done in the Amazon River, even in the areas of Thailand, there's such a thing as floating ag. You know? There will be ornamentals in some parts, but there's lots of things that can be done in a different way. But we have to look at resiliency. Ang dami-daming problema. So siguro ako yun yung mag-imagine. Baka patay na kami, baka saka nyo sila mas magawa. May minerasyon yun na. But anyway, we look forward to more innovation. And I'd like to announce we have Dr. Lali Ila, a speaker to our crop science classes seminar series on the 26th at 4 o'clock at Mendiola Hall, Agronomy Building. And he's the USAID Stride Deputy Chair of Party. So we challenge those bright minds to come. So he'll talk about his Stride experience and the spurring of innovation. And his experience in the sparring of innovation capabilities. Thank you.
Thank you very much.